There are places in the world that combine natural beauty with a rich and fascinating history, together with wonderful architectural heritage. We are definitely in one of those places, a country that is famous for giant constructions and the giant causeway. This is Northern Ireland, a land where nature is overwhelming, cities are cozy, and people are incredibly friendly. I start my trip in Belfast, strolling about the streets of the city centre. With a population of around 300,000 inhabitants, the city of Belfast is the largest city of Northern Ireland and the 17th largest one in the United Kingdom. The highlights of Belfast are many, although it is most popular for two things. One is the Titanic, and the other one is what the locals call the Troubles. However, I have no intentions to make any political insinuations. I just want to tell what I saw and how I saw it from a touristic point of view.
Could you stay for one more day? She said, I haven't had this fun in years, and I think you are to blame for that, my friend. We could build a castle in the woods, pretending we are king and queen, and act like heroes and set the people free, and then do it all over again.
I am in Belfast, the capital of Northern Ireland, also known as the Ulster. Taking advantage of the fact that I'm spending here a few days of holidays, I would like to show everybody the beautiful sceneries and highlights of this wonderful land. In addition, I would like to make a clear statement. After years of troubles, Northern Ireland has definitely become a great place to visit. If you just stay tuned for a few minutes, I'm pretty confident that you will agree with me.
The City Hall dominates the center of Belfast. It is located in Donegal Square, dividing the commercial and business areas of the city center. Built in Baroque architectural style, its magnificent facade provokes the fascination of visitors. Plans for the City Hall began in 1888, when Belfast was awarded city status by Queen Victoria. Construction actually started in 1898 and was completed in 1906. The construction of the City Hall was funded by Belfast Corporation, using the profits produced by the gas industry. Today, it is without any doubt one of Belfast's most iconic buildings. The city centre was originally located around Donegal Street, which is now mainly a business area, but with expanding residential and entertainment development, such as Victoria Square, an impressive shopping mall of 800,000 square feet. The city centre has plenty of pedestrian areas where visitors can take a relaxing walk, admire the wonderful architecture, and enjoy the friendship of the original Belfast inhabitants. The city of Belfast is crowded with a number of beautiful churches, either Catholic or Protestant. Restaurants, bars and pubs, many pubs, some of them of renowned fame as the Crown Liquor Saloon. Located in Great Victoria Street, it is an outstanding example of a Victorian gin palace where you can not only have your favorite drink, but you can also enjoy a dinner in family or with your friends and colleagues. Any drink or meal is welcome in a chilly spring evening in Belfast. In the center of the Cathedral Quarter, we find Belfast Cathedral, also known as St. Anne's Cathedral. It is a cathedral of the Church of Ireland, located in Donegal Street. The cathedral has stood for over 100 years as a place of Christian worship in the heart of Belfast. The semicircular arcs and massive pillars give the cathedral a lofty grandeur. The marble tiles and columns, together with the stained glass windows, create an atmosphere ideal for a spiritual experience. We move to West Belfast, a district mostly inhabited by Catholic that is best visited using a traditional black taxi.
Okay, this is my black taxi. It is not really black, it is white. But in reality, we should call it white black taxi.
Our driver is Patrick, a Catholic in his 60s that explains us his views of the troubles.
1962, things quiet here in Northern Ireland. IRA were thinking of going political route. They will tell you the trouble started along this stretch of road, 1969.
The Troubles is the common name for the conflict between Northern Ireland and the United Kingdom that expanded for more than three decades between the 60s and the 90s.
Then they decided to have a hunger strike. Bobby Sands here, over to my right.
Among the 3,500 people killed in the conflict was Bobby Sands, a member of the IRA who died on hunger strike while imprisoned. The main participants in the Troubles were Republican paramilitaries, Loyalist paramilitaries, and the British state security forces.
We go up one side of the wall, then we go the other side of the wall.
During the Troubles, a wall was erected to separate the west part of Belfast from the east.
See the wall dragging in front of me?
The tour includes a stop in Bombay Street, sadly famous for the violent riots that took place in 1969. Almost all houses in Bombay Street got burned during the riots. A memorial stands today in recognition to the fallen. The tour continues until we reach a big section of the wall. The view of the wall is definitely impressive, but what really impressed me was the fact that these yellow gates that you can see in the background still get closed every night, closing the connection between the west and the east. We finished the tour with a visit to the Protestant district, where the achievements of the Protestant over the Catholic are depicted in murals like the victory of King William III. Memorials to the fallen on the Loyalist side are also represented on mural paintings. Belfast is definitely the cradle of the Titanic. The tragic story of this famous ship is best experienced in the Titanic Belfast Museum. Housed in an iconic sixth-floor building, this state-of-the-art interactive exhibition offers visitors the true story of the Titanic, from her conception in Belfast in the early 1900s, through her construction and launch, to her famous maiden voyage from Southampton to New York City. The Titanic sank in the North Atlantic Ocean in the early morning of April 15, 1912 after colliding with an iceberg, resulting in the loss of more than 1,500 passengers and crew. The museum brings you deep into the stories of the passengers and the crew, all of them sadly earned a place in history. In the surrounding of the Titanic Museum, we find two giant gantries, Samson and Goliath, the twin shipbuilding cranes situated at Queen's Island. Goliath was completed in 1969 and Samson in 1974. Standing 96 and 106 meters tall, respectively, Goliath and Samson are the tallest gantry cranes in the world. Just a few hundred meters from the museum is located the Harland & Wolff shipyard where the Titanic was built. The exact location of the Titanic floating dock is really impressive, being its dimensions huge, enough for a vessel 269 meters long, the longest one by the time it was built. The construction of the Titanic began in 1909, when designer James Andrews laid the first keel plate in the shipyard. By the time the Titanic was designed, no facilities existed to build or berth such a large ship. So Harland and Wolff set about building the two new slipways required. Definitely impressive feats. No visit to Belfast is complete without a visit to some of its beautiful cemeteries. Most of them are located along Falls Road, a name associated to the Republican community in the city. Any cemetery in Belfast is a masterpiece. In my case, I decided to visit Belfast City Cemetery, situated in the junction of Falls Road and White Rock Road. Although unusual, cemeteries in this city are an attraction that I really recommend you not to miss. We leave Belfast and head to the northern coast of the island, where we can enjoy the beautiful scenery and sightseeing by the sea. Our journey starts with a 15-minute walk until reaching the so-called carrick-a-rede road bridge. The place is located about 100 kilometers from Belfast, near Ballintoy. The bridge links the mainland to the tiny island of carrick-a-rede. It spans 20 meters and is 30 meters above the rocks below. Only 8 people can cross the bridge at the same time for safety reasons. The site is not only interesting because of the bridge, but also for the impressive sightseeing around it. The bridge is mainly a tourist attraction, having about 250,000 visitors per year. Just 15 minutes by car from the carrick-a-rede road bridge, we find an impressive natural wonder, the Giant's Causeway. The path from the car park to the site can be done by bus or simply by walking 10 minutes, which is of course the recommended option. The Giant's Causeway is an area of about 40,000 interlocking basalt columns, the result of an ancient volcanic eruption. It was declared a World Heritage Site in 1986 and a National Nature Reserve in 1987. Most of the columns are hexagonal, although there are also some with 4, 5, 7 or even 8 sides. According to the legend, the columns are the remains of a causeway built by a giant. The story says that the Irish giant Fionn Mac Cumhail was challenged to a fight by the Scottish giant Benan Donner. Fionn accepted the challenge and built a causeway across the North Channel so that the two giants could meet. Whatever the explanation that you prefer, the beauty of the site is overwhelming, a perfect place to enjoy the wonders of nature. Next and final move takes us to Derry, officially Londonderry, the second largest city in Northern Ireland. Derry is one of the oldest continuously inhabited places in the island of Ireland. The earliest historical references date to the 6th century, when a monastery was founded here by Saint Columba, a famous saint from County Donegal. The town became strategically more significant during the Tudor conquest of Ireland and came under frequent attack. During O'Doherty's rebellion in 1608, it was attacked by Sir Cahir O'Doherty, who burned much of the town. The soldier and statesman Sir Henry Dougra made vigorous efforts to develop the town, earning the reputation of being the founder of Derry. The name Derry is preferred by nationalists and it is broadly used throughout the Catholic community in Northern Ireland and in the Republic of Ireland. Unionists prefer Londonderry, the official name, although in everyday conversation Derry is also used by most Protestant residents of the city. Our visit to Derry closes our trip in Belfast and Northern Ireland with a flourish. The beauty of the different sites that we have visited and the friendliness of people have really impressed me, making me feel like at home.